Pray. Heavenly Father, we're thankful to be here in this place. We're thankful that you are here with us. And we pray that you will fill us with your Spirit, that you will fill this place with your Spirit. Lord, we're here to worship you and praise you and honor you. And we love you and thank you for loving us. Lord, I pray for all the music, for the giving, and then for the message time. We pray for the invitation when the opportunity is for those to be saved or make other decisions. Thank you, Lord, for the joy of serving you. Thank you for being with us and living within us as your children. Please, Lord, forgive us of our sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Help us in every way, Lord, for we need your help, and you are the greatest helper of all. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. 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 You may be seated. My, it's good to see all of you here today. I just feel the Lord's presence here, and folks are still coming in. We're so thankful that we have this good attendance today. We have some visitors with us, and I don't know whether Gary will introduce his daughter. But Bethany is here, that's right. Where do you live, Bethany?
Jonesboro.
Oh, you're the one in Jonesboro. Okay, up there. Good to have you here today, yes. And then Gary, I'm sure he'll introduce his good friend, and now our good friend, Terry Clemons. And Terry, we're glad that you're here.
Thank you. It's on.
He's a singer. He's sung all over this country for the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's going to hear today with us in Derrick's. And so we're so thankful that we're going to have a great music program today. Well, Gary, come right on and lead us in worship.
Our word from today, comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 20. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection from the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But he did not raise him if, in fact, the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. It's my great pleasure to have my dear friend Terry Clemons. From the moment we met Terry, Terry adopted us as his family, and my wife is his sister, and our girls are his little nieces, and he's a grand uncle as well for our grandson. But Terry has a heart of worship and has sung this in our Easter musicals. We missed Easter this past year, at least as far as being in the Lord's house and celebrating with our choir and everybody. And Pastor's going to be bringing a message along this line today. But I've asked Terry to come and sing Because He Lives.
Ephesians 2 says, because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy,
made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. Because it is by grace you have been saved. Now let's all of us celebrate our victory in Jesus Christ and the saving message of the gospel. I believe in the Son. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends, because he lives. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the stone away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends, because he lives. I can face tomorrow because he lives. Every fear is gone. I know he holds my life, my future in his hands. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, every fear is gone. I know he holds my life, my future in his hands. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives.
Because he lives.
Let's all stand and worship our Savior together.
Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all our praise, you overcame.
Yes, Jesus, you did overcome for us.
Jesus, awesome and powerful forever. Awesome and great is your name. You overcame. Oh, Savior, worthy of honor and glory. Worthy of all our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome and powerful forever, awesome and great is your name, you overcame. Oh, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all our praise. You overcame. Awesome in power forever, awesome and great is your name. You overcame.
You overcame.
Yes, Jesus, you did overcome for us. You're our Savior. We glorify you, dear Lord. Thank you for what you've done for us.
You overcame.
Oh, you overcame.
O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then seeds my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then seeds my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think of God, his Son not sparing, send him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away our sin. Amen. Then seize my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, oh, how great thou art. Then seize my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come, and he will one day, with shout of acclamation to take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow with humble adoration, and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then seize my soul, my Savior, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then seize my soul, my Savior, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. How great thou art, how great
praise his holy name. We've really been blessed today, haven't we? Thank you so much, Gary and Terry and Norma, for singing for us and leading us in worship today. I want us to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And the children will go to children's church. I forget that every day. Brittany, take the children to children's church. Yeah, what is the age group on that? What have we been saying? I don't know. Heather, what is it? Preschool through first grade. Boy, that's a bunch of children today, isn't it? That's wonderful. Amen. Thank you, Madonna, for reminding us. We'd have just gone right on without if you hadn't helped us there. I forgot that today. But I'm just human, like you are, and I do forget things sometimes. Friday, we had a funeral service at Amity. My wife's first cousin, who lives in Alabama, brought his wife back to Amity to bury her. She was 81 years old. They asked me to do the service, and I did. We were at the Jones Cemetery right there at Amity. Her husband, they'd been married nearly 60 years. He was down by the casket. They had opened the casket there. It was a graveside service. And he was there looking at his wife. And the funeral director came up to his son and said, "You need to go down there to your father. He probably needs you." And so the son, who's about 55 years old and lives there in near Montgomery, Alabama, he went down to comfort his father. And I walked down there to stand beside them. And I heard the son who kept saying, "Dad, she's all right. Dad, she's so much better off now than she was. She had Alzheimer's for about 6 years. And there was a time when, because of COVID, he had put her in a nursing home and he couldn't go and visit her. So he said, 'Well, I'm taking her home.' So he brought her to his house and took care of her during this whole time until she passed away. But I was thinking of what the son said to his daddy, 'She's all right. She's okay. Dad, she's with the Lord. She's not suffering like this. We wouldn't want to bring her back like she was.'" And I listened and I saw the husband as he sort of gained composure to himself. But the hope of everlasting life, the hope of heaven, the hope of that wonderful place that we will go to someday is so real to us. As Christians, that is our hope, to be with Christ in heaven. I noticed this week in the newsletter from the Nashville First Baptist Church, there was a thank you note from Miss Shirley Wright and her daughter, Jennifer. As you all know, Barry Wright just died a few weeks ago, and we had his service. Well, you know, we've told the story about Barry. He got ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease. He got completely helpless, totally helpless, gradually. And so Shirley wrote a thank you note to the church, and I thought I'd share that because of what she said. She said, "Dear church family, Thank you for your prayers during Barry's ALS years. About 6 years he had that. We're so thankful for our church family. You've shown acts of kindness to us in so many thoughtful, loving ways. We appreciate your love, your concern, your prayers, and your faith. And here's what I wanted you to hear. She said, when the doctors told Barry that ALS patients only have a life expectancy of 2 to 5 years, if you get that word that you have ALS, they will tell you, you may live from 2 to 5 years. That's about the length of time. And she said, Barry replied to the doctor, I will have eternity with my Lord and Savior. What peace and comfort we have knowing that Barry is now in heaven with Jesus and free of all disease. No ALS there in heaven. No sickness, no sorrow, just a glorious heavenly place. And we've known Barry, and those of us who have known him so personally during these 6 years, and we knew him before that, we knew that he never gave up hope. Not that he would get better. He just always knew he was where God wanted him to be, and he was praising God right until the moment of his death. And I've always thought, Lord, help me to be that way. I hope that I will. I hope that you will. The hope of eternal life. When he told the doctor, who the doctor said, just a few years maybe, well, sir, I will have eternity with my Lord and my Savior. That's the kind of faith that you want to have, and that you want to have, that all of us want to have as believers. And our faith and our hope is based on the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want us to look here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning with verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel. Now that word gospel means good news. It is good news. It is not bad news. I declare unto you the good news, which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and in which you stand. Paul is writing to the church that was in Corinth. Corinth was a large city in that day. It was known as a very sinful and wicked city. You might think today about some city in America, maybe even in Arkansas, wherever you may be, that is known for its wickedness. And there are cities around our country that are known in that way. Well, Corinth was like that. And they just had so much idol worship. And people had horrible lifestyles. They treated each other in terrible ways. But a church was born in Corinth, in that wicked city. And Paul is writing to the church. He is being inspired by the Spirit as he writes. And he says, by which you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, that is, unless you really were not saved and believed in vain. Verse 3, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures. Now that's what the gospel is. If someone comes to you and says, what is the gospel? What really does it consist of? Then you ought to say what Paul says. It is that Christ died for our sins, that he was buried, that he arose again on the third day. That is the gospel. That is the good news. Now he goes on to say other things. In verse 6, he says he was seen about 500 brothers at once. Some of them have died. Some of them remain until this present time. Some have fallen asleep. And that he was seen of James and then of all the apostles. And last of all, he was seen of me. Paul was writing this, and do you remember when he saw Christ? He was on the road to Damascus, wasn't he? And the Lord came to him and spoke to him, personally spoke to Paul, and he was converted, he was saved. And he says, last of all, he was seen of me as one born out of due time. And then notice verse 9. Paul says, I am the least of the apostles, that I am not fit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. Paul was one of those Jewish men who believed that this new movement called Christianity was not of God. He didn't believe any of that was true. And he was such an unbeliever that he says, I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, and notice that, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. I labored more abundantly than all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, whether it were I or they, so we preach, and so you have believed. Now notice, beginning at verse 12. Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? Why, he says, if there's no resurrection, then we have no hope. We're all a bunch of liars. We're preaching things that are not true. If Christ has not risen from the dead. But you see, the last verse that Gary read at the beginning, verse 20, but now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. Believing in the resurrection of Christ is essential. There is no doctrine, there is no truth more important for us to believe than that Jesus Christ died, was buried, rose from the dead, and lives today. Our hope is based upon the resurrection. There are some people in the world today who even claim to be Christian, but they really don't believe in the resurrection. And those same people, some of them do not even believe in the virgin birth of Christ. Although they say they are Christians, yet they do not believe those basic truths that we believe. We cannot press hard enough that you must believe that Christ rose from the dead. As a matter of fact, you cannot be saved unless you believe that. There's one scripture in Romans in chapter 10 and verse 9. And I want us to look at that for just a moment. In Romans chapter 10 and verse 9, this is what Paul writes in Romans. He says, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. So that verse tells us right there that unless you believe that Jesus arose from the dead, you're lost. You cannot be saved. Now you may say, well, I don't really think that's necessary. I don't even know whether I really believe that story or not. You cannot be saved unless you believe that Christ rose from the dead.
And I'm sure that all of us in this room and all of us listening in can say, we believe. We believe he died. We believe he was buried. We believe he rose again from the dead. And he lives today. Hallelujah. Because he lives, we can face tomorrow. I love that song that you sang. Because he lives, that's why we have hope. We have so many friends, and I've said that lately, that I almost get depressed. Anna knows that. So many of our friends and family that are passing away. But as I said Friday, standing around the graveside, I said to the family and all those friends who were there, this precious lady was a believer in Christ. The moment that she died, her spirit went into the presence of the Lord. Now, I believe that with all of my heart. The Apostle Paul said, if we are absent from the body, we are present with the Lord. So at the moment that she died, her spirit went to be with the Lord. I said, we're burying her in this casket. We're going to put her down into the ground, and they will put dirt over the casket. And I said, that's not the end of her story. Her spirit is with the Lord, even now, in a blessed place with the Lord. But I said, one of these days, Jesus is going to return. Christ is going to come again. And I quoted for all of them the passage in 1 Thessalonians where Paul said, I would not have you to be ignorant, my brothers, concerning those which are asleep. He said, one of these days, Jesus is going to come back again. And so I read that scripture, and I'm looking for it right now, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 13. You may want to look at that because you may be basing your hope on something else. But as a believer, this is what it is. Chapter 4 of 1 Thessalonians verse 13. I would not have you to be ignorant, my brothers, concerning those that are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others who have no hope. Paul doesn't tell us not to sorrow. I do sorrow, don't we, Bobby? You sorrow when you think of Wayne, and we sorrow as well. That is normal. That is natural. Mike here, he's lost his mother and his father. Sorrow in our heart is normal. Paul says, we don't sorrow, though, as others who have no hope. You see, if you should die and you are not a Christian, you are lost, you're unsaved, your family knows that. All who know you know that. And you die, and you gather around, there's a different kind of sorrow. I've seen it sometimes at funerals where they were weeping and wailing because they had a feeling, or knew more than a feeling, that this person was not a Christian. This person was lost. This person had never been saved. This person had never come to Christ, never been baptized. And so all the family and the friends gather around and they know this person is gone and we'll never see him or her again. There's a sorrow that of hopelessness. I guess what I would say, Gary, you know, don't leave your family like that. Don't leave your friends like that. Whenever you pass away, I hope and pray that they will know where you're going. No doubt in their minds, you're going to be with Jesus. That's the assurance that we need to have in all of our life. And you can make sure that your family knows that. If you're a man or a woman or a child, your relatives. He says, we believe that Jesus died and rose again. Even so, those who sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall not precede those that are asleep. I looked about the cemetery at the Jones Cemetery, and I saw all of those monuments, all of those markers, and all of those names, and I was looking around at the hundreds and hundreds of graves, and I thought about this. It says, those who sleep in Jesus, those who are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord, shall not precede those that are asleep. And I thought, all of those who are Christians, all of those who are believers, when Christ comes again, they're going to be resurrected. And so I said, Sue there, who is going to be in this grave, in the ground, her body is there, her spirit is with the Lord. But when Jesus comes back again, when he comes back again, hallelujah, praise the Lord, that body is going to be resurrected. She's going to have a new body, whole and free. And in her new body, she will go to be with the Lord. And I said, in these graves all about us here, when Christ comes, folks are going to be resurrected. Now, for some, that sounds kind of spooky, doesn't it? And then some of y'all love those, you know, the living dead on television, that series, and you watch that over and over and over, and you see those people. That's a spooky kind of a show, the living dead and all of that. Well, it's going to be that when Christ comes, all of those who have died in him are going to be resurrected, have a brand new body. Those of us who are living at that time, the Bible says that we're going to be transformed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. That's in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that we are going to be transformed. So it's like this. When Christ comes, and if Jesus were to come at 12 o'clock, I'm looking at the watch and the clock, Jesus could come today at 12 o'clock. There's nothing keeping him back. There's nothing keeping him back except God's will and God's plan. But at the right time in history, Jesus is going to come again. And when he comes again, there's that great resurrection. All of our loved ones, all of our friends who have died in Christ are going to be raised. We, if we're alive, and he came at 12 o'clock, we would be transformed, and that's something else. Beam me up, Scotty. we're going to be transformed, and we're all going up into heaven with Christ. I cannot imagine what that's going to be like. It's going to be like nothing that I've ever thought of, nothing that we have ever seen at the resurrection when Christ comes. So all of the dead from all of the world will be resurrected. All the saved, all the believers will be transformed, and we'll all go up into heaven. What a grand reunion that's going to be. I can hardly wait for the idea of seeing my mother and my father and my dear friends like Barry and many others who have gone to be with the Lord. I will see them again. I'll be with them again. I will know them again. Some say we won't know each other in heaven. Yes, we will. We will know as we are known. I'll know you, and I'll know you, and I'll know you, and I'll know you. And we'll know each other in heaven. What a glorious thought that's going to be, reunited with our loved ones forever. As Barry said, for all eternity, 1,000 years, we sang the song around the grave Friday. I led them in singing Amazing Grace. And we said, when we've been there 10,000 years, but I said we could say 10 million years, or 10 billion years, or 10 trillion years, forever, for all eternity. But then I thought, those who are not Christians here today, As I thought about that around the grave, I said to all of those, if you're not a Christian, if y'all are not saved, if you don't know Christ, we're all going to be resurrected and transformed and go to heaven, but y'all are going to be left behind. And that made me so sad, because as I looked around, and as I look around here, and I think of all the ones that do not know Jesus, I mean, there are millions, billions of people on this planet that don't know Christ, and they will be left behind. We'll be gone. The church will be gone to be with the Lord, and then all hell will break loose. And that's a good way to say it, I guess. You understand what I mean. And you could read in the book of Revelation all the things that are going to take place after that. My desire is that no one be left behind. If you're here today and Christ doesn't live in your heart, you know that you're not saved. I hope, I pray, I wish that you would come to Christ. You see, the Savior is waiting. He really is waiting for you to come to Him. Has there been a time in your life when you understood that you were lost, when you knew that you would go to hell if you died? Has there been a time when you understood that you were a sinner? Has there been a time when you understood that God loved you? Out there at the graveside, I said, why don't we say John 3:16? And there was only one little girl that was there at the funeral, sitting over there with her mother. Her mother is a third grade school teacher, I found out. But when I said, you all know John 3:16, that little girl just brightened up and said it with me. Why don't we say it together this morning? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That is what the gospel, the good news really is. Y'all were saying it as well. God so loved the world. He doesn't hate the world. He loves the world. He loves you. He loves you. And He loves you so much that because of your sin, God wanted you to be saved. And so He sent Jesus into the world to be your Savior. And that's the good news. That's what it is. Christ came, lived on this earth about 33 or 34 years. All during this time, He was teaching and preaching and performing miracles and telling people about Himself. And many people were coming to Him for salvation. And then He was buried, and He rose again on the third day, and He appeared to many. And then He went on back up into heaven where He'd come from. And He said to all His disciples, now you all, go ye therefore into all the world and make disciples, teaching them, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them all the things I have taught. And from that place, that hillside, that Mount of Ascension, where Christ went back up into heaven, the disciples were scattered abroad and began to preach and teach the gospel. That's what Christianity is all about, based upon the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. This morning, if there are those of you here, or maybe even watching and listening, and you don't know Christ as your Savior, you may say, well, Brother David, I don't know when the day to be saved is. Hey, this is the day for salvation. The Apostle Paul said, behold, now is the time of salvation, and it is now. You may be saying, Brother David, I hope one of these days that I can do what you're saying. One of these days, when I feel it real strong, I'm going to pray and ask the Lord to save me. When I feel it strongly, when something happens to make me feel that way. I'll tell you, you need to come to Christ. The day of salvation is now. The Holy Spirit is moving among us and in this place. And it may be that today is the day when you will say, oh yes, I believe Jesus died and rose again. And he died for my sins. And therefore I want him to be my Savior. Let us bow our heads and pray. And if you want to be saved today and you have never made a decision for Christ, why don't you do it today? I mean, do it now. So your family will know one of these days when they bury you, you want them to rejoice and not weep and wail because they know you went to hell. You could pray a prayer. Now the prayer is because you believe. You must believe the Lord Jesus Christ. But if you believe all these things about him, why don't you pray this prayer? If you've never prayed it before, and if you really maybe prayed it before and didn't mean it, why don't you pray with me right now? Pray like you can say it out loud or just silently. Dear Lord, I know that I need you in my life. I know that I am not saved, I'm lost. I know I'm a sinner, I admit that. But Lord, I know you're the Savior, and I know you'll save me if I'll only trust and believe in you. So Lord, I do with all my heart. With everything about me, I believe in you. Please come into my heart and save me today. Save me now. Oh, Lord, I'll follow you. I'll be baptized. I'll begin to serve you and tell others and witness about you. Please, Lord, come into my heart. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.